أفحكم الجاهلية يبغون ومن أحسن من الله حكما لقوم يوقنون.
الحمد لله رب العالمين وبه نستعين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن اتبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. Last week we spoke about the some of the maqasid of the Sharia, and we said that really the Sharia, it comes to protect six different elements with regards to the Ummah, or six different components of the Ummah, and these are components that are vital or essential components of the Ummah, that if some of them were lost, then it can corrupt the Ummah as a whole. So there were six of them that we spoke of. What are they? Or we spoke about three. You weren't here. Tayyib. So the first one, you were here. What did we speak about? We said that the Sharia has to protect the deen, right? We said the first thing that the Sharia has to protect is the deen. Because the deen is really the most important part of any ummah or even any part of an individual, because the deen is what provides success in this dunya and the deen is what provides success in the akhirah. So if the sharia doesn't protect the deen, then we said that a person might have success in this dunya, but he will have failure in the akhirah. And how did we say the sharia protects the deen? Well, there are different ways by doing it. For example, we spoke about الأمر بالمعروف والنهي عن المنكر, that enjoining the good and forbidding the evil. We said that the Sharia does that, or it commands the people to do that, male or female, that if you see a munkar, then you stop it with your hands, and if you're not able to stop it with your hands, then stop it with your tongues, and if you're not able to stop it with your tongues, then at least dislike it in your heart, right? So we spoke about that, alhamdulillah. And we said another example is قتل المرتد, right? We spoke about the killing of the apostate, right? Because, you know, the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, من بدل دينه فاقتلوه, that whoever changes his religion, then kill him. And then we said the reason behind that is because these people might not only would they leave Islam, but they might start to spread things that are untrue about Islam and start planting the seeds of discontent amongst people of the Ummah and cause a greater corruption than to just get rid or deal with that one individual. And we also spoke that, you know, this isn't something that that is upon the individual to look after himself, but there are judges that deal with these matters and ulama that deal with these matters, but not for the, you know, the ammi person, the general person, to go and implement this this hukum himself. But we spoke about that, and you know, also you have the prohibition of innovating things in this deen. The hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, من أحدث في أمرنا هذا ما ليس منه فهو رد, that whoever introduces something into this matter of ours, meaning this religion, then it is rejected. And you know, it protects against, you know, people coming and thinking that they're bettering the deen by introducing things that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never did, or the Sahaba never did, or was never taught, is not found in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or from the sunnah of his Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Sharia absolutely prohibits this, right? So this is the first thing. We said the Sharia has to protect the deen. The second thing that we said the Sharia has to protect is what? No one was paying attention last week, huh? Or sorry, it was 2 weeks, huh? We didn't have a halaqah last week, so 2 weeks. Maybe that's why. We'll excuse you guys this time. The Sharia has to protect the nafs, right? Because it is the individuals that make up an ummah. What is an ummah? An ummah is like a gathering of the of a people, centralizing the people together, worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala together. This is what makes up an ummah, right? And if the Sharia doesn't protect the individuals, then you wouldn't have an ummah. You'd have individuals looking after themselves. We said that the Sharia absolutely prohibits monasticism. You know, someone going out and isolating himself in the woods, or going living in the mountains by himself. The Sharia absolutely prohibits this. Islam is a communal religion. There's individual components of it and there's communal components of it. So the Sharia has to protect the individual, because if the individual isn't protected, then you can have a great corruption that can enter into the ummah, or you can have a complete disbandment of the ummah. So how does this sharia protect the nafs? How does the sharia protect the nafs? These aren't even things you had to have been here for the last halaqah to know these things. But how does the sharia protect an individual? It prohibits the killing of someone else, right? Doesn't the sharia prohibit the killing of someone else without just cause? Of course. You can't have lawlessness out there and people going and killing whoever they want. No, the sharia protects the life and the blood of an individual. It protects, unless someone has wronged someone else with that which deserves had punishment against him that takes his life, the sharia protects the life of that person. Right, so you can't go and kill people. So this is one way that the sharia protects the individual. Right, the sharia protects any sort of transgression against the individual, enslaving people. Outside of, for example, war, it's haram to go and just take someone and make him your slave. You can't do that. Islam commands the rights to individuals. It commands. It protects the blood and it protects the wealth and it protects the honor of individuals. If similarly, and we'll speak about that a little bit today here as well. But the sharia has to protect the nafs. It has to protect the individuals, because if the individuals don't feel that they're protected, what will they do? They'll leave. They'll get up. They'll go somewhere else. They might, or there might not be anyone left because everyone's been killed or everyone's been mistreated, right? So the sharia has to protect the nafs. The third thing that we spoke about is what? Now there's Khalid. Khalid has his notes with him. What was the third thing that we spoke about? What does the sharia have to protect? What's that?
The wealth.
The wealth, المال, right? The sharia has to protect the mal. And we said that mal doesn't just mean money, dollar bills and cents. No, the mal is anything that a person benefits with. So it could be a car, or it could be a house, or it could be animals and livestock that they get milk from and they get meat from. All this, anything that a person benefits from, this is mal. And this has to be protected by the sharia. And we said, for example, that the way, one of the ways in which the sharia protects this is it absolutely prohibits stealing. You know, the sharia allows you to, the deen allows you to go and accumulate as much wealth as you want, right? But it prohibits it accumulating it unlawfully. So for example, through riba, it prohibits this, or through cheating, it prohibits this, or through gambling, it prohibits this. And it prohibits someone taking the wealth of another person. So it prohibits stealing. And we spoke about the had for stealing. We spoke about that briefly. So the sharia protects the mal as well. So we have the deen, and we have the nafs, and we have the mal. And today we want to speak about the additional three components that the sharia has to protect. And who can give me, who remembers what the next one is? Or one of the other ones. There's six we mentioned, right? An-nasl. We said that the sharia has to protect an-nasl, which is the descendants and the offspring. Because just as the sharia protects the nafs, the individual, the sharia also has to protect the offspring of that individual to ensure the continuity of an ummah. Because without offspring, without descendants, then an ummah would come to a standstill after a generation. And we spoke about, you know, what happens in China. I think we spoke about the nasl last week, the previous week, didn't we? Did we speak about that? I can't remember.
I don't think so.
But we, in any case, even if we didn't, we said that the sharia has to protect the offspring of the individuals in order to ensure the continuity of a society, because if the sharia doesn't protect this, then either generations won't continue, or a generation would come to an end, or people, and there's different ways that it protects the individual. One example that we spoke about, I think it was 2 weeks ago when we spoke about it, we said that the Sharia absolutely prohibits, for example, the killing of an unborn or a newborn, right? Without just cause. And we spoke about, for example, like what happened, the recent study about China. Because they're only allowed one child, so everyone only wants males. So what happens when they have a female and they don't want a female because they want a son to work the land or to carry on the name? Well, the problem that they have is with so many sons and no daughters that 20 years from now, all these sons have no one to marry, right? So they have a huge issue right now because they didn't protect the nasl, they didn't protect the descendants, whether it is from the male side or it is from the female side, but the nasl has to be protected. So the Sharia protects the ruh, and there's ijma' amongst the scholars that once the ruh is breathed into a fetus, then it is absolutely prohibited to stop it without just cause. And just cause might mean, for example, like it is known that there's going to be cause death to the mother or something like that, and there's nothing that they can do to prevent this from happening. So there are exceptions, of course, that have to be done, but they have to be looked at by Muslim doctors, and they have to study it, and they have to give, there should be agreement amongst them that this is the case, and it is permissible in order to stop that. Allah Ta'ala alam, yeah, there's different ahkam concerning that, but in any case, in general, once the ruh is breathed into the fetus, then it is absolutely prohibited to put an end to it. And even before that, we're not saying so that once you find out, you know, once a person finds out, a woman finds out she's pregnant and it's only 1 month into the pregnancy and the ruh hasn't been breathed in, we're not saying it's halal to perform an abortion before that. No, it's not. It's still haram to do that. But once the ruh is breathed in, it carries a heavier weight of tahrim. And there's different ahkam, of course, like even with a miscarriage that happens before the ruh is breathed in and after the ruh is breathed in. And this is an entire like fiqh discussion in itself, but there's different ahkam with regards to that as well. But in any case, this is what we say, is that the Sharia protects the descendants even before they're born, or the offspring even before they're born. And the Sharia, if the Sharia does not protect the ties of kinship between individuals, then this also causes disunity in the family and it causes disunity in the ummah. So the Sharia has to come in order to protect the relationship between the parents and their children. And this is what is referred to as al-arham, that the Sharia maintains the ties of, or it is absolutely prohibited for a person to break the ties of arham. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, هَلْ عَسَيْتُمْ إِنْ تَوَلَّيْتُمْ أَنْ تُفْسِدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَتَقْطَعُوا أَرْحَامَكُمْ أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ لَعَنَهُمُ اللَّهِ فَأَصَمَّهُمْ وَأَعْمَى أَبْصَارَهُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, would you then, if you were given the authority to do mischief in the land and sever your ties of kinship, such are they whom Allah has cursed, and so that He has made them dead and blinded in their sight. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks very harshly about those who break their ties of kinship. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has cursed these individuals, and we'll find many ahadith that speak about the dangers of severing the ties of kinship, such as the hadith of Jubair ibn Mut'am radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَا يَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةِ قَاطِعَ رَحْمٍ, that the none shall enter, he shall not enter Jannah, the one who severs the ties of kinship. This hadith is in Sahih Muslim. And it doesn't mean, of course, that this person will never enter Jannah, right? But this it's a great sin without a doubt, it's a kabira without a doubt, but it doesn't mean that a person will never enter Jannah, but it goes to show the severity of it, that this person will not enter Jannah immediately, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will judge with regards to his affairs afterwards. So the Sharia protects the nasl through this, and it also protects the Sharia, protects the nasl through the means of conception as well. What do we mean by this? We mean that the Sharia prohibits any sort of unlawful interaction between men and women that would cause children to be born from here and there, and people not knowing who their fathers are or who their mothers are, you know, when they give birth and they just adoption and all these things that take place, the Sharia absolutely prohibits this type of interaction. And one of the ways that it does it is something that we're going to speak about in the Usul al-Fiqh a little bit more, and this is called Sadd al-Dhara'i. Sadd al-Dhara'i, meaning blocking the means, which is a qa'ida or a principle that we're going to discuss a little bit more. And what it means is that even though something in itself might not be prohibited, but the Sharia blocks ways that can lead to this prohibition, right? So anything that can lead to that which will disrupt the nasl, then the Sharia forbids it. An example of that would be a woman traveling on her own. You know, the Sharia prohibits a woman from traveling on her own because some danger might come to her, some harm might come to her. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "La tusafir al-mar'atu illa ma'a dhi mahram," that a woman is not allowed to travel except with a mahram. This hadith is in Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim. And some people, you know, mistakenly say, well, okay, this, she's safe, you know, she's traveling in a secure car by herself and no one can stop her. And because she's safe, then it means that, you know, she's halal. This hadith doesn't say that because she might be unsafe. It doesn't mention that. This hadith only says it is prohibited for a woman to travel without a mahram. And this is what we take from this hadith. We don't have an illah for it to say that this is the reason why it was prohibited, and if this reason has been fulfilled, or you know, the conditions have been fulfilled for this, then it is permissible to for her to travel on her own. And this is not the case. So we say that we don't know the exact reason for the prohibition, but in any case, if we look at it from the side of danger that can come to a woman, then we say it prohibits it from that regard as well. And just as it is not permissible for her to travel, it is not permissible for her to have, you know, for the woman, for example, to have men in her home when they are alone. Uqba ibn Amr radiallahu anhu, he narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Iyyakum wad-dukhul 'ala an-nisa," that beware of entering upon the women. And then a man from amongst the Ansar, he said, "Ya Rasulullah, afara'ayta al-hamwa?" He said, "O Messenger of Allah, what do you think about the brother-in-law?" And you know, and you can see, subhanAllah, the reason why he asked this, or why the companions asked this, is because even now, amongst people today, they think, well, this is my brother-in-law, or this is my sister-in-law, they're family now, and it's permissible for us to be together without a mahram, and this is absolutely prohibited. And listen to the reply of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, "Al-ham al-maut." He said that the brother-in-law is death. And there are a number of reasons for this, and one of the opinions of the scholars why the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said this is because some people think of it as being so innocent, but once a relationship takes place between the brother-in-law and or the sister-in-law and the husband or the wife, then it leads to what? It leads to death. Right? So this is why people might think of it as something being so innocent, but no, the had is carried upon this, the zina that has taken place, that can take place. And subhanAllah, we know people of this, or that this has happened to, where, the father goes away to work, the wife is left at home, and his brother is staying with them, you know, comes from overseas and is staying with them. And subhanAllah, we've seen cases where this has led to a complete destruction of the family because of what happened between the brother and the person's wife. Wal-iyadu billah. And similar to any sort of privacy between non-mahrams is also forbidden. And we say non-mahram, what we mean by this is someone that is permissible for you to marry. So for example, some people might say, well, this is my cousin, it's okay for me to be with her, or it's okay for me to be with him, if it's a woman. You're allowed to marry cousins in Islam, so it's not permissible for you to be with this individual, right? This is considered, they're non-mahram to you. You're allowed to marry this person, you're not allowed to be with them by yourself. If you're not allowed to marry them, then this is permissible for you, like your sister or your aunt, your maternal aunt or your paternal aunt, you're allowed to be with these people because it's haram for you to marry these individuals, right? And also, like, for example, a sister from Rada'a, a nursing sister, if you have someone like that, or a nursing brother, if you had someone like that, you're allowed to be with each other because it's haram for you to marry each other. Haram for them to marry each other, right? And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لَا يَخْلُوَنَّ رَجُلٌ بِمْرَأَةٍ إِلَّا كَانَ ثَالِثُهُمَا الشَّيْطَانِ, that a man and a woman are not together alone except that the shaitan is their third. So some people might say, well, you know, I'm old and I know my limits and this person, he knows his limits and we're very respectful of each other. No, the Sharia prohibits this because who is there? The Messenger of Allah says the shaitan is their third. The shaitan will get the best of individuals and perhaps take the situation to that which is even further. And this is, of course, as we said, this hadith is reported by Tirmidhi, and it is comes with a sahih isnad according to the conditions of al-Bukhari and Muslim. So this is with regards to an-nasl, or the nasl, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it protects the nasl by sadd al-dhara', as we mentioned, by blocking the means. So if something might not be haram in and of itself, it can lead to that which is haram, and if it can lead to that which is haram, then it becomes prohibited in the Sharia. Is there any questions about that right now before we go on? Nasl al-zid, fadala.
For example, it is prohibited if the woman can go without muharram to the Hajj as a group of women?
Na'am, yes. And the reason for that is the hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is pretty clear. So the question was, is it permissible for a woman to go and perform Hajj if she's traveling with a group of women, or let's say she's even traveling with a group, a large group in general? So some people say, you know, when you're in the airports, you're on the planes, you're always with someone, you're never alone. And is it permissible to do that? And the evidence for that they use, those who say that it is permissible, they use the hadith of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, that she performed Hajj during the Khilaf of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and that she was, of course, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was dead during that time. Others reply to this by saying, no, the hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is pretty clear that it is not permissible for a woman to travel without a mahram, right? This is pretty clear. Second, they reply to this hadith, and they say there is absolutely nothing in this hadith that indicates that Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha did not have a mahram with her. So it doesn't have to be the husband, but for example, like Abdullah ibn Zubair was alive, and Abdullah ibn Zubair is her nephew, right? He can go with her, and she had other relatives that she can go with as well that she's not permitted to marry. So this is really the only evidence that they use to show that. And it is weak when you look at the other narrations that we have, the clear prohibition plus nothing in this text that would indicate that she wasn't traveling with a mahram. So we have no indication otherwise that they traveled without a mahram, and the hadith is pretty clear. So for a woman to travel and perform Hajj, then she has to have a mahram with her. Okay, a group of women does not constitute a mahram. Does that make sense? Inshallah. Any other questions? Okay. The next way that the Sharia, or the next component of an ummah that the Sharia has to protect, is al-'irb. Al-'irb, which is what? The honor or the dignity of an individual. Because just as the ummah protects the blood, the nafs and the nasl, which we said are physical manifestations of components of an ummah, the urb is something that's non-physical, right? Honor is something that's non-physical. Status is something that's non-physical, but it is just as important. And an ummah that does not protect the honor and the dignity of its subjects will lead to corruption, and it will lead to chaos, and it will lead to rebellion, and it can lead to the shedding of blood as well. So the Sharia has to protect the honor of individuals as well. And this goes for the protection of a person's nobility, his honor, or a person's family. Islam protects all of this. For example, Abu Dharr al-Ghifari radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he narrates and he says that one day a dispute arose between himself and another Sahabi. And some go on to say that this other Sahabi was Bilal ibn Rabah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, but this is not correct, or there's it's extremely weak, so we don't know who this other Sahabi is. Suffice it to say that Abu Dharr al-Ghifari radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he got into a dispute with another Sahabi. And he went and he insulted this person's mother. He went and insulted this person's mother, who was a non-Arab. So he insulted her for being a non-Arab. So this person went and complained to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called Abu Dharr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and he asked him, did you indeed do this? And Abu Dharr radiallahu ta'ala anhu replied, and he said, Ya Rasulullah, man sabba rijal sabbu abahu wa ummah. And he said, oh Messenger of Allah, it is customary between us that if someone insults you, then you insult his father and you insult his mother, right? And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam replied back and said, Ya Aba Dharr, innaka mru'un fika jahiliyyah. He said, oh Abu Dharr, you are a person in which in you exists jahiliyyah, pre-Islamic ignorance. And this hadith is in Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim. And of course in Musnad Ahmad, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, don't curse your fathers. And a person said, oh Messenger of Allah, which one of us would curse our fathers? And the Prophet ﷺ said that you curse another man's father, so he comes back and curses your father, right? So you didn't intentionally curse your father, but you cursed another man, or you cursed his father, so he came back and cursed your father. And this is what led to this, and this is a Sahih Hadith as well. So Islam prohibits or protects the honor of individuals, it protects their dignity, it protects their status. And another way by doing this is, for example, the prohibition of backbiting, of ghiba. Islam absolutely prohibits ghiba. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu Hurairah radhiyallahu anhu, he narrated that one day the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to his companions, he said, "Atadruna mal ghiba?" Do you know what is ghiba? Do you know what is backbiting? And they replied back and they said, "Allahu wa rasuluhu a'lam." They said, "Allah and His Messenger know best." He said, ذِكْرُ أَخَاكَ بِمَا يَكْرَهُ, that you mention your brother in that which he dislikes. Now, the Sahaba, they asked, a person from the Sahaba, he asked, أَفَرَأَيْتَ إِنْ كَانَ فِي أَخِي مَا أَقُولُ. You know, he said, well, what if there is this thing in my brother that is true? I'm saying something about him. I know he might dislike it, but what if what I'm saying is true? Is it still considered backbiting? He's asking, it's a legitimate question, right? So, for example, let's say this person, he's always going around insulting other people. So you speak about him and say, oh, this person, he just goes around and insults other people, and you're speaking about him in a bad way. And we're going to speak about, that might not be the best example, but, maybe he eats like unmannerly. He makes a big mess whenever he eats, and he's always like spilling food all over the place when he eats or something like that. So you speak about him like that, right? It's true, he's doing that. When you invite him, you always have to clean up after him when he eats, right? It's true. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "In kana fihi ma taqul, faqad akhtabta, wa in lam yakun fihi faqad bahattahu." He said that if there was indeed in him that which you said, then you have backbitten against him. Meaning, if it's true what he's doing, but he dislikes it. The Messenger of Allah said that he dislikes knowing someone talking to him about him, then you have committed backbite against him. And if it's not true, maybe this person is actually well-mannered when he eats. He doesn't put his elbows on the table. He's got, the proper salad fork and the shrimp fork and all the other different forks, and he's using them properly, right? Then you have slandered him. The Messenger of Allah ﷺ said, then you have slandered him. And this hadith is in Sahih Muslim. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا يَغْتَبْ بَعْضُكُمْ بَعْضًا أَيُحِبُّ أَحَدُكُمْ أَنْ يَأْكُلَ لَحْمَ أَخِيهِ مَيْتَ فَكَرِهْتُمُوهُ. That the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Hujurat, that, and let none of you backbite against one another. Would any of you like to eat the flesh of his dead brother? You would dislike that, meaning so hate, dislike ghiba just as much as you would dislike to eat the flesh of your dead brother. And of course there are different categories in which it is permissible to speak about someone even though he might dislike it. So there are certain categories, and one of them is complaining. You know, such as you're going to a judge and you're complaining about a situation that has taken place or something that has happened. You know, you got into a car accident and you say, oh, this person was driving recklessly. It was like he was driving, you know, all over. He wasn't staying. You're speaking about him, but you're complaining about it. So it's permissible because you're going to a judge and you're telling him, you know, he was doing 120 on the Hyundai and the speed limit is only 100. And so you're complaining to a judge about what this individual did. It's permissible in this case. Seeking help to change an evil and to bring back an individual. So let's say you're going to a person and you're saying, you know, this is what this person is doing and I need help in order to bring him back to the haqq. It's permissible to do that. Seeking advice or getting a fatwa. It is permissible to go to a judge or an alim and to say, you know, my father does this, or my mother does this, or my brother or my sister does this, and then you're mentioning the bad thing that they're doing, and this is because you're trying to get an opinion or scholarly opinion. Another case in which is permissible is if you're warning against an individual. So you say that this person, for example, he's a mubtada, you know, this is what he's doing, and he's saying that this is a part of the deen, it has nothing to do with the deen. So it's permissible to do that. And you know, subhanAllah, I remember when I started working at the university hospital, one of the brothers that I work with there, he wanted to go and pray Jum'ah in the musalla there. In the university hospital, there's a musalla there. And I happen to know the khatib, who gives the khatab there. And the one thing I know about him, and this is because I confronted him directly myself, and this person is from the Qur'aniyin, meaning he does not accept the ahadith, and he only believes in the Qur'an. So he completely rejects the ahadith. So I told this brother, I said, no, you can't go pray behind this person, and this is because of what he does, right? So I warned against him, and he said, Jazakallah khair, because it's not permissible to pray behind someone who has this belief. This is kufr. Right, if you only accept the Quran and you reject the Sunnah, this is kufr. All right, and we'll speak about that more, bi'idhnillah ta'ala.
Even you don't have to mention the name when you're talking about somebody else.
Yes, exactly. Well, I mean, when you say this is the khatiba, this is, you know, he's doing it, and yeah, so people are going to come to know. And if it is a person, you know, that sometimes you have to mention the name, right? So that they know I should stay away from this person because, you know, for example, in this particular case, this person is a kafir. He's, you know, it's not permissible to pray behind him. A salat behind him would be batal. So you'd have to say, don't pray behind this individual because the salat behind him would be batal, right? So you have to. So in any case, if you're warning against an individual, then it is permissible to do this. Another example of when it's permissible is for identification purposes. Okay. So for example, you know, there's many people that come here and their name is Ahmed or something like that. So how do you tell the difference between them? You might say, you know, Ahmed al-Tawil or Ahmed al-Samin or Ahmed al-Qasir or something like that. You know, they might not necessarily like this label, right? But you don't know how else to classify them or differentiate them between each other. And you know, really even amongst the scholars, then they did have names for their people like Abdurrahman ibn Hurmuz, rahmatullahi alayhi, is from the Tabi'een. He narrated many ahadith from Abu Hurairah radhiyallahu ta'ala anhu and others. They used to call him Al-A'raj, the lame. And he was known by this. They would say, Haddathana Al-A'raj, right? And this is because he had a limp. And this is how they would recognize him. This is how they would know him. Or similarly, you had Sulaiman ibn Mihran, who is Al-A'mash. They would call him the lame. The weak-eyed one, right? And this is how they would come to know one another. Or you had like Humayd al-Tawil, and he wasn't actually even Tawil. He, you know, Humayd the tall. They said he was average height, but there was another Humayd who was shorter than him. So to differentiate between them, they would say this is Humayd al-Tawil or Haddathana Humayd al-Tawil. All right. So they would label each other like that. And similarly nowadays, you know, you can, someone can come and say, well, Harith told me this. And I say, well, who's Harith? I know like 20 different Hariths. Who's the Harith that you're referring to? And you can say like, you know, the handsome one. he's the one that informed me of this. So it's okay to assign these types of labels or something like that if it is for the purpose of identification, but not in terms of slander, right? So you're not saying, you're not using it to slander the person, but just to so that people know exactly who it is that you're speaking of, especially in cases where it can cause confusion. So, and there's a difference between the scholars, is it a kabira or is it a saghira? It's a ghiba, is it a kabira or is it a saghira? Imam an-Nawawi rahmatullahi alayh, he mentioned that it is a kabira, a saghira rather, and a kabira, others took the opinion that it was a kabira, such as al-Qurtubi rahmatullahi alayh. And they mentioned, for example, the ayah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and an example they use is قذف المحسنات, المحصنات, that when you slander a chaste woman, for example, this is a type of slander against them. It is a ghiba against them, it is slander against them, as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned, and the ayah that they use for that is وَالَّذِينَ يَرْمُونَ الْمُحْصَنَاتِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَأْتُوا بِأَرْبَعَةِ شُهَدَاءِ فَاجْلِدُوهُمْ ثَمَانِينَ جَلْدَةِ وَلَا تَقْبَلُوا لَهُمْ شَهَادَةً أَبَدًا. That those who slander the chaste women or accuse the chaste women, meaning of having unlawful relations, and they do not bring four witnesses, then lash them 80 lashes and do not accept from them a testimony ever. This is what we'll mention, we'll speak about this here, but there's two types of punishments. There's uquba haddiyya nasiyya, a punishment that is a had punishment, and there's a nas for it, and there's uquba ta'ziriyya ijtihadiyya. Okay, so there's two types of punishments. Uquba haddiyya nasiyya, meaning that there is a specific punishment for that individual according to the sharia. It is a punishment that comes from the sharia. So for example, accusing a chaste woman of having unlawful sexual intercourse and you can't bring four witnesses, then what's the had punishment for that mentioned in the ayah? 80 lashes, right? 80 lashes. Did we translate the ayah? I think we did, right? So for those who don't, it's from Surah An-Nur, right? So this is a had punishment. We call it a had punishment because the sharia has brought a punishment for that specific act. Okay? This is uquba haddiyya nasiyya. Uquba ijtihadiyya, ta'ziriyya ijtihadiyya. This is what we call ta'zir punishment. What it is that it's a punishment where there is no punishment associated for it in the sharia. There's no punishment for it in the sharia, and it's left up to the ijtihad of a qadi, for example, right? So let's say, for example, you insult a person, or you say, you know, all this person's mad came from riba or whatever, and it didn't. And you go to a judge, and the judge judges between you. He might say, you have to, as punishment, you have to get, pay him. You have to get, pay a fine to this person, this individual. Well, there's nothing in the sharia about that, right? And we're not introducing a new hukm to the sharia. We're not doing that because this can differ between individuals. And but it's up to the qadi, for example, to judge something. So, for example, even nowadays we say that, and we're going to actually speak about that when we speak about al-masalih al-mursala, when we speak about in usul al-fiqh. But for example, we will see that, you know, here they have, if you go over 80 on white mud, or if you go over 70 on yellowhead, the speed limit, there's a punishment. What's the fine? Well, they've set their own fines. Is this fine from the sharia? It's not from the sharia, right? It's ijtihadiyya, and they've come up with these things. Does that make sense? And of course, for someone to for someone who commits ghiba, then what he should do is he should go and mention to this person what he did. He should apologize to this person and get the forgiveness of this person. But ultimately, it's up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala whether he's going to forgive this person or not, because only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows if this tawbah was a sincere tawbah or not. Right? So this is still left up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but a person should go and he should apologize and seek the forgiveness of his brother or sister for that which they did. Does that make sense, inshallah? And these two types of uqubat, does that make sense? Like the punishment that is ta'ziriyya, ta'zir punishment, and a had punishment, does that make sense? Okay, please.
Just to add that though, like, you tell the person, because that's his haqq. But if it's causing more problem, then I think you don't have to tell me.
No, that's يعني it depends as well. Yes, you're right. If it's going to cause like a bigger issue, to go and tell him what you did and it will cause a fitna, then you make istighfar and you pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives us. But as we mentioned, there's no kafara for it. So we don't say that there's a kafara or even a had punishment for it. Right? This is for al-'urf, for the honor of an individual. Is there any questions about that before we cover? I think we have one last one that we'll speak about. Any questions about the honor of an individual? No? طيب. So the last component of the sharia the components of an ummah that the sharia has to protect is the aql. It's the reasoning and the rationale. Islam protects the aql because the aql is the means to accomplish anything. So if the sharia does not allow the people to think, or does not allow the people to rationalize, or it does not protect the rationale of individuals, then it could lead to, again, as we mentioned, it could lead to chaos, it could lead to rebellion, it could lead to the shedding of blood. And the aql is being protected, we're not just speaking about the mind, but we're speaking about the qalb as well, what is in the heart. Because we're guided by the heart. It's not always the mind that we rationalize things in, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about our qalb being that which we are guided by as well. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَفَلَمْ يَسِيرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ فَتَكُونَ لَهُمْ قُلُوبٌ يَعْقِلُونَ بِهَا أَوْ آذَانٌ يَسْمَعُونَ بِهَا فَإِنَّهَا لَا تَعْمَ الْأَبْصَارُ وَلَكِنْ تَعْمَ الْقُلُوبُ الَّتِي فِي الصُّدُورِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Hajj, have they not traveled through the land and have hearts through which they understand and ears by which they hear? Truly it is not the eyes that go blind, but the hearts that are in the chests that go blind. So a lot of times, like we speak about, you know, philosophers have this whole issue about the conscience. Well, what is the conscience, right? And this is something that science hasn't even really been able to explain. But we say that this is the heart. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about it in the Quran. And of course, we also have it in the hadith of An-Nu'man ibn Bashir, who narrates that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Al-halalu bayyinun wal-haramu bayyinun wa baynahuma مشبهات لا يعلمها كثير من الناس فمن اتقى الشبهات استبرأ لدينه وعرضه ومن وقع في الشبهات كراع يرعى حول الحمى يوشك أن يواقعه ألا وإن لكل ملك حمى ألا وإن حمى الله محارمه ألا وإن في الجسد مضغة إذا صلحت صلح الجسد كله وإذا فسدت فسد الجسد كله ألا وهي القلب. This hadith from Nu'man ibn Bashir radiallahu anhu, he narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the halal is clear and the haram is clear, and between them are matters which are doubtful or suspicious, that many people don't have knowledge concerning them. So whoever saves himself from these matters then saves his religion and his honor. Right? The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says saves his religion and his honor. And whoever indulges in these suspicious things is like a shepherd who grazes his animal near the private pasture of a king. He's liable, or it could be that his sheep are going to go and graze into this pasture of the king, which will get him into trouble. And of course, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, indeed every king has a hima, meaning like a private protected area, and the hima of Allah on the earth are his prohibitions. Truly, in the body is a morsel of flesh. If it is good, then the rest of the body will be good. And if it goes bad, then the rest of the body will be bad. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Ala wa hiya al-qalb, indeed it is the heart, or truly it is the heart. And this hadith is in Sahih al-Bukhari. So in this hadith, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explains that there are matters that some people might find doubtful or might be in doubt about. So it is best to avoid them in case that a person might fall into the wrong. And it is the heart that guides, but that which protects the heart are the prohibitions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the heart guides us, but what guides the heart is when the heart realizes or comes to know the prohibitions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what is halal and what is haram. And the aql through the mind is also protected by the sharia. So the sharia comes to safeguard the heart, And this is through the ahkam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but it also protects the mind as well. Also through the ahkam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we see this in the, for example, when we speak about the prohibition of alcohol, right? Even before it was prohibited as entirely, it was prohibited only when a person was coming for the salat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu la taqrabu salat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تقربوا الصلاة وأنتم سكارى حتى تعلموا ما تقولون, right? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O you who believe, do not come to the prayer while you are intoxicated until you know that which you say. So, meaning if a person drank and he's intoxicated and he's not clear about his understanding, this is before the full prohibition of khamr, then you're not allowed to come to the prayer in this case. And of course the salat is wajib. So you had to make sure that if you were drinking, you weren't drinking in a time that you knew that you're going to be followed by the prayer. And in fact, this ayah came down with regards to Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And he narrates this hadith and he says, صَنَعَ لَنَا عَبْدُ الرَّحْمَنِ ابْنِ عَوْفِ طَعَامًا فَادِعَانَا وَسَقَانَا مِنَ الْخَمْرِ فَأَخَذَتِ الْخَمْرُ مِنَّا وحضرت الصلاة فقدموني فقرأت قل يا أيها الكافرون لا أعبد ما تعبدون ونحن نعبد ما تعبدون. So this is for those who understood this, Ali ibn Abi Talib رضي الله عنه, he narrated and he said that عبد الرحمن ibn عوف رضي الله عنه, he prepared for us a meal, and he invited us and we sat down and he gave us wine to drink and we became intoxicated from the mind. But you know, the salat came, and subhanAllah, you can see, like, even the salat comes, you, no matter what state they were in, the sahaba would pray. So they pushed Ali ibn Abi Talib, or they put him as their imam, and Ali ibn Abi Talib radhiyallahu anhu, he led them in prayer and he began to recite from Surah Al-Kafirun, and he recited قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ, say, O you disbelievers, لَا أَعْبُدُ مَا تَعْبُدُونَ, I do not worship that which you worship. But then he said, وَنَعْبُدُ مَا تَعْبُدُونَ, or وَنَحْنُ نَعْبُدُ مَا تَعْبُدُونَ, and we worship that which you worship. So he completely negated what he just said. You know, first the ayah says, I don't worship that which you worship. And then he said, but we worship that which you worship. So then he says, فَأَنزَلَ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَقْرَبُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَأَنْتُمْ سُكَارَى حَتَّى تَعْلَمُوا مَا تَقُولُونَ, O you who believe, do not come to the prayer while you are intoxicated until you know that which you say. This ayah is from Surah An-Nisa, and of course this hadith is in Jami' al-Tirmidhi, Sunan Abi Dawood, al-Mustadrak al-Sahihain, and it comes by the way of a Sahih Isnad. So the Sharia came to protect that even from the very beginning. It was protecting the Salat. It didn't make alcohol completely prohibited, but it was protecting the Deen and protecting the Aql, which can, as we said, can come to compromise the deen. And of course then it became completely haram in a hadith from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of course revealed, ya ayyuha alladhina amanu innama al-khamru wal-maisru wal-ansabu wal-azlamu rijsun min amal ash-shaytan fajtanibuhu la'allakum tuflihun. Oh, you who believe, intoxicants and gambling and al-ansab, which are the stone altars which they used to sacrifice on, and al-azlam, which are the arrows of divination. They used to use these arrows to determine their destinies. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, are an abomination of the shaitan's handiwork, so avoid them in order that you might be successful. This is in Surah Al-Ma'idah. And Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, kullu muskirin khamr wa kullu muskirin haram, that every intoxicant is an alcohol and every intoxicant is haram. And what we mean by intoxicant is anything that befogs the mind, anything that doesn't allow a person to think straight. So if someone says, well, there's no hadith that specifically says cocaine is haram or marijuana is haram, we say this hadith says it's haram. It befogs the mind. It intoxicates. It doesn't allow you to think straight. This hadith is in Sahih Muslim. And another narration, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, كُلُّ مُسْكِرٍ خَمْرٍ وَكُلُّ مُسْكِرٍ حَرَامٍ, that every intoxicant is a khamr and every khamr is haram. And of course we said that in usul al-fiqh, the sharia uses the principle of sadd al-dhara'i, right? Blocking the means, which we spoke about. And we said that that which can lead to the haram is also made haram. And this is why Jabir ibn Abdullah radiallahu anhu, he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ حَرَّمَ بَيْعَ الْخَمْرِ, that the Messenger of Allah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger, they made prohibited the selling of alcohol. Alright, so it's even prohibited for a Muslim to sell it to the kuffar. This tijara is completely prohibited. It's not permissible to sell it. And it's unfortunate that you see some Muslims who have restaurants and they have alcohol that they serve to the kuffar. And they say, no, we're not selling it to the Muslims. This is just for the kuffar. Well, this transaction is haram. It is not permissible. And Abdullah ibn Abbas, he narrated that he heard the Prophet say, أتاني جبريل فقال يا محمد إن الله عز وجل قد لعن الخمر وعاصرها ومعتصرها وشاربها وحاملها والمحمولة إليه وبائعها ومبتاعها وساقيها ومستقيها. He said the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, Jibril came to me and he said, O Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, Allah the Majestic has cursed alcohol and the one who squeezed it, and the one who asks for it to be squeezed, and the one who drinks it, and the one who carries it, and the one for whom it is carried for, and the one who sells it, and the one who buys it, and the one who pours it, and the one for whom it is poured for. All these things, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has cursed these individuals. This hadith is in Musnad Ahmad with a sahih isnad. And the Sharia commanded in the whipping of the one who drinks with 40 lashes, and we're going to actually speak about that a little bit more when we speak about qiyas. But the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would in hadith Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim and others, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have the one who drank lashed with jarid, which is like the palm fibers or the fibers of the palm trees. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have them whipped by that, and Abu Bakr anhu would whip them 40 lashes, and Umar ibn Khattab then increased it to 80 lashes, and we'll speak about that when we speak about the issue of qiyas. So there's a had punishment for the one who drinks that we find from the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that they used to beat this person. So the aqil has to be protected as well, because as we said, it can compromise the deen if it is, you know, for example, like we saw in the case of Ali ibn Abi Talib, how he completely changed the meaning of the ayat that he was reciting when he recited under the influence, right, of alcohol. So the Sharia has to protect the aqil both from the mind and from the heart. Does that make sense, inshallah? I mean, we have. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك احمدك واستغفرك واتوب اليك واشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له واشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله جزاكم الله خير والسلام عليكم